welcoming you in with the sounds of Phantom of the Opera, Think of Me. And that's what we want to do today on the Mueller Sports Report, is we want to think. We want to think. And on an early Wednesday morning, thinking is not always the thing we want to do. But as some of you have seen, if you follow me on Instagram, I have attempted to put myself in a different kind of time zone, working out early, going to bed early. My wife has a bakery, and so she gets up about 4 in the morning. And so instead of staying up late and doing some things and trying to be productive, I am doing the opposite, and I am getting up early and going to bed early. So while it is still during the 6 o'clock hour, I have been up for a couple hours, got a nice good workout in, breakfast, and here we are. So again, the goal is to think. And so first I want to make sure we talk just quickly about the rebrand here at the Mueller Sports Report. And so I went over it in the last episode, but we will no longer only be focusing on the Browns. So the OBR Straight Talk didn't make sense to keep that name, even though I am still with the OBR. And so today's podcast is all about the Cavaliers. So if you have no interest in the Cavs, the good thing is when you look at the podcast name, it'll first tell you what we're talking about on that day. So if it is something that you are not interested in, a subject that you are not interested in, you will know that in advance and don't have to feel like I'm wasting your time or setting you up for anything. So that is where we're at with the Mueller Sports Report. I am your host, Jared Mueller. You can get a hold of me on Twitter at Jared K. Mueller. That's at JaredKMuellER. And so we're going to jump right in to talk about the Cavaliers. And obviously the big story over the last week or so has been Kevin Love, as he would call it, his immature reaction, his frustrations, his childish engagement with what's going on with the Cavaliers. And so really I want to talk a lot about Kevin here, specifically as, again, as many of you know, I am a counselor. I've been a counselor for 18 years. I am currently an independently licensed social worker with a supervision designation, and in that, I am at the highest of my licensure. And so a lot of the things that we talk about here on the Mueller Sports Report is going to be around some of the things that I may see differently based on that history, right? So master's degree from the Ohio State University, undergrad from Wright State University in Dayton, Ohio, just to give you a little bit about my background. So Kevin Love, listen, we all know what he has done for mental health, bringing it to a forefront, making it something that people are willing to talk about a little bit more, starting with panic attacks a few years ago and using his platform for that. Obviously, I think that's great, right? That is something that people, men, athletes, all across the board, right? Those groups, people in general don't like talking about their emotional health. You know, it's almost no different than talking about religion, politics, money. Right in there is emotional health. Like, how are they doing, right? And then men, we tend to struggle a little bit differently and a little bit more. There's this idea that is implanted in us for a variety of reasons that being strong and being a good man means not being emotional, not being impacted by things, whatever wording we want to use. That's really what happens for men in our society. Now, obviously, like anything, there's a spectrum to that, right? Someone who shows zero emotion and tries to be stoic all the time and thinks men are only strong because they don't show emotion, or the only emotion they show is excitement or anger, right? That's one side of that spectrum. And then the other side of the spectrum is the man who has no control, or the person, right? We don't always have to just talk about men, but again, as a man and as someone who understands kind of the pressures, men have a different way of dealing with that. And I've never been a woman, so I don't know how that is only for women. I can know it very specifically for myself. So on the other end of that spectrum is the idea of just showing all your emotions, not having really control of your emotions, expressing everything, right? Just everything's emotional. Everything's a big deal, right? And it's kind of like the boy who cries wolf. If everything's a big deal, absolutely nothing is, right? So when we look at Kevin Love, someone who talked about kind of holding it in, trying not to show his struggles, trying not to let people know that things were difficult for him, and then to start to share that and start to be open about it and all of those kind of things. I think what you're really seeing here is kind of the swing in that spectrum, right? If you go from the idea that you're not supposed to show emotion, which Kevin has talked about feeling that pressure, whether someone's told him or not, feeling that pressure to I'm able to, and it's important for me to show my emotions, and it's important for me to share and be open and all of those things, which I absolutely agree with, then there's going to be some times where your lack of experience in that can lead you to sharing maybe a little too much. And I'm not saying Kevin Love shared too much per se, but what I am saying is if you go from totally bottling everything up to I want to do this appropriately and I want to share appropriately, then sometimes you're going to show lack of self-control because you haven't practiced. It's no different than working out or lifting, you know, lifting weights, eating healthy or whatever is it's hard, right? It's sometimes you'll go overboard, you'll lift too much, you'll hurt yourself, you'll cut out something that was actually healthy for you in your diet because someone told you it was unhealthy to eat that thing, and so you go to this crazy extreme, or you'll fall back, right? I mean, it's natural to fall back into things you've always done, and so it's very possible. And again, I am a mental health professional. I'm not seeing Kevin Love. I'm not evaluating him clinically. I'm evaluating him from afar. But it's very possible that these most recent incidents could lead Kevin to kind of swing back the other way a little bit and kind of struggle with bottling things up a little bit, right? Because that's the natural progression as we try to learn and grow as people into who we're going to become, is we kind of swing. And we're really trying to find our borders. We're trying to find our growth pattern. We're trying to see how this works for us, right? Someone who doesn't show any emotions and bottles everything up, and someone who lets his emotions or her emotions fly, neither of those are generally healthy. Somewhere in between is, and I think Kevin's trying to find that, right? If we're being really honest, it can be very difficult for a professional athlete. Again, throw money out the window. It doesn't matter. When Kevin's on the floor or when Kevin's practicing or whatever, he's not thinking about or experiencing his bank account at that point in time. At that point in time, it is his job. While it's a job almost all of us would want, maybe all of us, it is his job. The same way most of the time at work, whatever job you do, if you work or if you're a stay-at-home parent, if you whatever you do, most of the time, you're not thinking about how much money you make. There are times where you think that. You may think, I don't make enough money to deal with this, or, man, I'm glad I get paid, or I wouldn't be doing this, or sometimes, man, I can't believe I get paid to do this, right? But a majority of the time, you're not thinking about your money. So when Kevin's at work, it's like you and I being at work. It's just an awesome job that pays a crap ton more money than most of us make. By the way, if you're someone who makes that kind of money or anything near that kind of money and you want to sponsor the Mueller Sports Report, as long as we can match up ethically and all of those kind of things, I would love to have a conversation with you. Again, please reach out to me at Jared K. Mueller on Twitter, JaredKMueller. I would love to represent you. Send out advertisings, whatever I can do so that you can use your money sponsoring and taking care of someone who is pretty decent, I guess. That's me. Sorry, that's the real quick. But honestly, if you do have a company or whatever and you think that this could be a good place for you to advertise, again, please reach out to me. I do mean that sincerely as much as I mean if you're a multimillionaire and you want to help and be a part of this, please reach out as well. So we look at Kevin. He's at work. He's experiencing these emotions. He's trying to figure out his norm. He's trying to experience that. And in a lot of ways, there's a lot that probably is going on inside of Kevin, whether he knows it or not, whether he's consciously processing it, he probably is, or not, really around two other things. So there's a first part where trying to figure out who he is, his emotions, all of that, like that's a process. That's not a quick thing. That's not a 1 year thing. It's not a 2 year thing. We should always be doing that. I have a belief that growth and development is a requirement of all healthy people, right? So this is a Jared quote. I don't think I stole it from anybody, but growth and development is a requirement of all healthy people. It's not an option, right? So Kevin is in a few years into really experiencing this emotional understanding and all that kind of stuff. So it's a growth process for him. But beyond that, I think one of the things that we've seen over from Kevin Love over the last year or so is a realization that he was never and will never be a 1A. And that for a professional athlete, one that's paid well, one that is thought highly of, one that has thought highly of himself, is probably pretty difficult, right? So you look back at his Minnesota days, never able to carry them to the playoffs, could blame system, could blame the players around him, whatever it is, but never able to carry them to the playoffs. And then the Cavs, when LeBron left, unlike the year, the last time LeBron left, the first time LeBron left, pretty much came back as is the following year, because Kyrie Irving had already been traded the year prior. So when LeBron left, the team that LeBron carried with Kevin Love no longer could do much of anything, right? So he goes from a Minnesota time where he couldn't lead him to the playoffs to the same team with LeBron. Obviously, LeBron's amazing, but that's pretty much same exact team was terrible. Now, everybody had injuries. Yeah, yeah, yeah. There's a lot of other things going on there, but there starts to be a realization there for a player that, man, it was me, right? And again, it's not saying Kevin Love is not good. He's not great. Whatever terms we're going to use, he's just never going to be a 1A. When he signed that extension, I believe his belief was he had a chance to prove he was a 1A type. I don't think he thought he was competing for a title, but his belief was he could lead the team to the playoffs, to be competitive, all of those things that we heard that first year LeBron was gone. And then it didn't happen. Ty Lue was out pretty quickly, all the changes. So that realization has to be tough, right? And then we know about his frustrations or seeming frustrations with Colin Sexton. And I think the other piece to that puzzle is Sexton was seen as kind of the guy that was going to come in and help Kevin Love. And it didn't work, right? And then Sexton's play style, let's use those terms, affects Kevin Love's ability to be traded, right? So not only is he not going to be a 1A, but Colin Sexton dribbles too much, yada, 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 doesn't pass, doesn't see the floor. Not sure that's going to totally change ever. All of a sudden, that impacts Kevin Love's value outside of the Cavs and his ability to get traded, maybe places that he wants to be, get whatever, whatever. So not only is Kevin Love struggling with all of the figuring out his emotions and who he is, and yeah, all the things that, I mean, those are real. Those are real and those are important. The realization that maybe I never was going to be the guy, that 1A to take people where they want to go, I was never going to be able to do that. Now, could he be a 1B? I think there were times he was that for the Cavs behind LeBron, and Kyrie was 1C. Not as much, but that happened. But in the NBA, you need a 1A, and that's not Kevin Love. That's a realization. That's a difficult realization. And then his frustration with Colin Sexton. Obviously, he wants to win. Obviously, that's important to him. But I think there's also a piece where how Colin plays, his inability to see passes, to feel the game in that kind of way outside of a one-on-one offense, and even, honestly, one-on-one defense can impact Kevin Love's ability to get traded. So I think when we look at Kevin Love, it's not as simple as they're losing. It's not as simple as Colin Sexton and he gets frustrated by his style of play. I think there's so much more going on there that's really important that we think about. And again, that's why we started with Think of Me, because I just wanted to have everybody think a little bit this Wednesday morning on the Mueller Sports Report. So if Kevin Love isn't happy, and again, on the Mueller Sports Report, my goal is going to be, as often as possible, to keep them between 30 and 45 minutes, somewhere in that range, sometimes even shorter. That's because I want to be really respectful that people's time is valuable. So some of you have commutes of 30 minutes or so. Some of you have 30-minute lunch or 30 to 45-minute workouts, whatever it is. So I hope that I'm able to value your time in a way through this. So if Kevin Love's not maybe happy with how things are going and where things are for him, what about the Cavs? Should the Cavs be happy with where they're at, given the 2 years removed from LeBron James, given everything that they didn't have, right? So when we think about their rebuild, they didn't have assets and they didn't have cap space. And they had very few young players, right? That's what almost every LeBron James team ends up with at some point. It seems like it's one of the reasons he chooses to leave. Cleveland was capped out, asseted out. Miami, obviously, had Wade and Bosch coming in, but they had some young players with Chalmers and those kind of things. Udonis Haslem was younger then, all kinds of stuff. So he went there. It allowed some fresh newness. When he came back to the Cavs, it was pretty much all young players, right? So he got that fresh newness with a Kyrie Irving co-star. Kevin Love got brought in. They knew that was going to happen. So when LeBron left, the Cavs had no cap space and no young players, right? Basically, their young players were Ante Zizek. Colin Sexton was a draft pick at that point. I mean, he was the 8th overall pick coming in. They had Jetty Osman. And that was about it, right? That was really who their young players were. And so, given where they were to where they are, in the NBA, the rebuilds take a significant amount of time. They just do. Even if, whether you're tanking or not, the ability to create a team again, especially when you have to dismantle, is really tough. Look at Miami, which is seen as kind of a destination, no Florida tax, you're in Miami, Pat Riley, Eric Spoelstra, all of that history, and they're still struggling with their rebuild. You know, they think Jimmy Butler, they had to trade a bunch to get him, but they think Jimmy Butler can be, again, I don't think he's a 1A, but they're hoping that him, along with Tyler Hero and some other pieces, will come together. But that rebuild has been going on for kind of years now. Wade left to go to Chicago, came to Cleveland. A lot of things happened over those years, and they're still trying to kind of figure it all out. And that's a destination with top guys and reasons to be able to recruit people, whether they're free agents or not. Cleveland's not that. It never will be. Unless LeBron's around or LeBron James or Bronny comes there, whatever happens. So the Cavs are not far into their rebuild, and it's going to take time. And I'm going to say I think the Cavs are fine. The Cavs are in a fine place for where their rebuild is. They were able to acquire some assets. They were able to move some players around, use those assets to really bring in players that they hope can be a part going forward. And that's really going to be the key, because when we talked about Colin Sexton, here's the thing. For Cavaliers fans, he was the next big thing. He was the hope. And some level, subconsciously, he was the Kyrie Irving for this next build. But the difference in the NBA between the number one overall pick and the 8th pick is huge. I would probably say it's probably the difference between picking a quarterback in the first 10 picks of the NFL draft and picking a quarterback in the 4th round. So if you're a football fan, those expectations of a top 10 quarterback versus a 4th round quarterback are probably the correct expectations of Kyrie Irving in the number one overall pick and Colin Sexton at the number 8 pick. It's not Colin Sexton's fault that he was brought in to replace LeBron, Kyrie, whatever, to be the next kind of hub, because he was the first pick after all of that. That's not Colin Sexton's fault. It's not Colin Sexton's fault that Dan Gilbert and company really believed that LeBron was leaving, so they didn't use that number 8 pick to bring in a veteran to help with one more push because they didn't think they could do it anyways, right? With KD and everybody that was in Golden State. That's not Colin Sexton's fault. If Colin Sexton was the eighth overall pick on a team that was good, already had some talented players, and he was thought as a piece, if you thought of Colin Sexton as probably a sixth man who could start at times, expectations would be different. Again, is Colin perfect? No. Last night, again, they didn't pull it off against Detroit. They lost 31-18 in the fourth quarter. That's what happens with young teams, right? Colin Sexton, 35 minutes, 7 for 19, 20 points, right? But 2 assists, 2 rebounds, 1 steal. It's all the other things that tend to struggle a little bit. Obviously, 7 for 19 is not great. 7 for 16 for Jetty Osman, not great. Especially when you look at Kevin Love's numbers of 12 for 15 for 30 points and 9 rebounds and 4 assists and a steal, right? So that's kind of what we're looking at, but the Cavs are fine. Colin Sexton, just because we wanted him to be, doesn't mean he can be, right? I think Darius Garland is coming along. He's starting to get a feel and a flow. You have to remember he played a total of 4-plus games last year at Vanderbilt. So there's a lot of things about speed and comfort and all of that that he has to figure out. He also is used to having the ball in his hands, and him and Sexton figuring those things out are going to be really important, as well as then we look at Kevin Porter Jr. Obviously, the Jordan Clarkson trade was made to give KPJ a more opportunity. And I think you add another player that likes to have the ball in his hands and is good with the ball in his hands, and I think you're starting to see a team that has people who do things well. And when you talk about a rebuild, that's what matters. It matters that you have players who do things well. That's it. Everything else can be figured out, but do you have players who do things well? The hope is that Dylan Windler can come in and show that he can rebound, defend, and shoot the three, right? Again, are we talking about a starter? Probably not. We're not talking about Kevin Love Light over there, but it's possible that he could start every once in a while. Could he be a sixth, seventh man? Can he do enough to contribute to a team that's led by Garland, Sexton, KPJ? Is that possible? Because that's what you need. You need players who do things well. The rest is all about filling in and creating a roster. But in the NBA, fit, which is a David Griffin thing, and we love Griff, fit is important when you're talking about competing. Fit is less important when you're talking about building. When you're talking about building, you want fit for culture and fit for being able to kind of play together. But really, when you're talking about building a team, starting out, kind of getting that rebuild going, you just want players who do things well. Colin Sexton can get to the hole. He's getting better at it. He's fast with the ball. His spot-up shooting improved greatly last year. It's gone down a little bit this year, but he can do things well. Darius Garland is showing that his shot will come together. His feel for the game is so much greater than Colin Sexton with his usage. Again, last night with 14 points, he was only 4 of 12, but he was 2 of 5 from three-point land, had 4 rebounds, 3 assists, 2 steals. There's a different feel to the game for Darius Garland. Now, can Garland be the number one? I don't know. I don't think so. But again, when we look at Steph Curry, and I'm not saying Darius Garland will be Steph Curry, I just like to use examples we all know. When you look at Steph Curry, he wasn't Steph Curry right away. He could shoot. He had a feel for the game, but there was so much that Steph Curry had to get figured out beyond his ankles and his health issues. So again, I think the Cavs are fine because they're figuring out that they have players who can play, who have ability, who have skill. And the other part is I think John Beilein's culture is taking hold. Now, with players speaking out earlier in the season, Tristan Thompson snapping at his coach during a timeout, Kevin Love, it could be really easy to think that I'm just going rose-colored glasses, and it's possible. But But I think when you see a team that's competing, last night the Cavs had Dean Wade played 6 minutes, Zizek's got 16 minutes, Brandon Knight 24, Delly got 19, and then he literally played all of his starters 32 minutes or more. The only starter who played less than 35 minutes was Tristan Thompson. And so foul trouble, all kinds of different things going on there. So you look at all of that and you still see a team who competed, who had the lead into the fourth quarter, right? Had a decent lead going into the fourth quarter and then got tired. But again, when you're playing all five starters over 30 minutes, when you're playing Brandon Knight 24 minutes after basically not playing most of the year, all of a sudden, you start to see that maybe a culture is taking hold. Because that's a game that, in the past, when the Cavs have been rebuilding, you've seen a give up. I think John Beilein has a system and a culture that is working. So I think the Cavs are fine because I think they found a coach that, as long as he wants to coach there and health and all that kind of stuff, because he is a lot older for a rookie NBA head coach, I think they have what they need there. And then the final thing is, I think the vets that they have on the team have trade value. And so we'll talk about that in a second. But as I often do, I'll talk a little bit about food because I love food. Can't we all connect on food? So one of the things I'm just going to encourage, again, I'm using Instagram to kind of focus on health a little bit. And really, it's going to be a lot of just stories. So I don't really want to have just a ton of pictures of me working out or the equipment I'm using or the food I'm eating or whatever. But and again, I'm not that guy, right? Like, my wife's a baker, and you'll see some of the sweets that I eat on Twitter. Woo, I get some good stuff, y'all. But one of the things that I did one weekend is, so my wife got me a smoker for my birthday. My birthday is the day before Halloween. If anybody wants to send gifts, let me know. You got a long time to prep, to save, to get me a really awesome gift. But for my birthday this year, my wife got me a smoker. And so one weekend, I went to the store. We actually have a meat market that actually sells my wife's breads and desserts and stuff like that. And so I picked up a bunch of meat. So in total, I got basically a brisket. I got a huge pork shoulder, and I got two whole chickens, right? So total, all of that meat was about $40. And then I put the meat in the smoker, did all the stuff I need to prep it, put it in the smoker, cut it up, put it into little packages. Again, this took time, but the cool thing with the smoker is I just let it go, checked on it, did the little things I needed to do every hour or two, and did everything else with my life. And then I let it cool, and then I shredded some, cut up some, whatever, and stuck stuff in the freezer, right? So basically 1 to 2 pounds of each thing in the freezer. And I only bring all of that up to say, I just encourage all of you, for financial and health reasons, you don't have to have a smoker. You can stick crap in the oven and do basically the same thing. But doing that has allowed us to really create a lot of different meals really, really quickly. I don't have a plan for tonight, but the last 3 nights has been the day before or the day of, hey, I'll go grab this vegetable or this rice or whatever, and we'll put it together with this meat. We'll pull it out of the freezer. Boom, ready to go, right? And that's the kind of thing that I think all of us can do. It takes some time and preparation, but in the end, can save you tons of money from eating out, saves you from only eating kind of unhealthy prepackaged things. So I just encourage you, if there's ways for you to prepare, whether it's on the weekend, weekday, whatever works for you, to prepare whatever the types of things that are good for you, do that. It's just something that can be really, really healthy. After I get done with this, on my way to work, I'm going to drink a smoothie. My wife, we got frozen fruit, some almond milk, and some random other healthy things, some kale or spinach or whatever. Threw it in a blender, blended it up, threw it in some mason jars, and now we have smoothies for the rest of the week, right? That's just how easy it can be, because it has to be easy, y'all, because I ain't doing it if it's not somewhat easy. So that's why my gym is a half mile from my house and open 24/7, because I know my limitations. They are many. So we'll finish off. We're hitting about the 30-minute mark. So I'll finish off real quickly with my final Cavaliers thought for today, and that's that I think the veterans on the team have trade value, which is good for the team and can be good for the long-term build. I think the Cavs did the right thing by keeping a lot of their veterans over time, because it allowed the young guys to kind of build and grow and be, feel comfortable versus being forced into playing big minutes. Kevin Porter Jr. is a great example. I don't know. It's not that much time, but what would it have been like if he had to soak up 25 or so minutes when he first started in the NBA? As someone who played at USC for 1 year, youngster, all that stuff, that pressure and all of that could have really affected his development, but he didn't, nothing was given to him. He earned Jordan Clarkson's trade, basically, right? So I think the Cavs did right by keeping their vets because it helped their young guys, which is their number one priority, right? So just getting talent doesn't matter if they can't develop, if they can't over time get better. Having veterans around can help for a variety of reasons. Stabilize, teach little things, just show them where to shop. I don't know. Tell them to make smoothies and smoke some meats or put them in the oven, whatever. Like those things are important. But now we're getting to the point where a few of them are going to no longer be under contract. So time to move them, right? Or possibly time to move them. So we'll start with Kevin Love. Here's the reality. His contract is huge. His injury history is a concern. He's not a 1A. He just had these blow-ups. So we got all that, right? Given all that, guess what? Kevin Love is still the best player available on the trade market. He is the best player available on the trade market. That has value, folks. Again, whether that's Portland or whoever, I don't know, but it has value that Kevin Love is the best player on the NBA trade market. What they get for him, I don't know. Can they get a young guy? Can they get a second round pick and the young guy and this, that, or the other? I hope. The issue for the Cavs is that matching salaries can be tough, and that's part of the NBA that makes trades somewhat difficult. So that's really where I'm going to be interested to see is how do the Cavs navigate this, right? They have a decent amount of cap space next year, even with Love under contract. But if they're able to match contracts in a way that they get someone who's under contract just for next year, for Love, who's under contract for multiple years, I think it could be really interesting. And it's something they've tended to do, right? They did it with Rodney Hood. They've done it possibly here with Brandon Knight here in a second. We'll talk about that's just something they've been able to kind of finagle a little bit. So Love is the best player available, should be able to bring back assets if they can work through some of the money stuff. Again, even if Kevin Love brings back just a young guy, so from Portland, Little, the small forward, power forward, is someone that I like a lot. If he brings back Little, a second round pick, and then whatever needs to happen to match salaries, I think you have a deal that makes sense for the Cavs and it makes sense for Portland, who wants to get over the hump, or any other team that could benefit from Love. He is still the best player available on the NBA trade market. And then you have Tristan Thompson. To be honest, I think Tristan could have more value, at least in trade, than Kevin Love. He's not a better player overall than Kevin Love, but what he does very, very well, and he's very, very good at it. If the Lakers or Clippers had any assets to trade, and I won't pretend like I've really looked a ton at their young guys, but I know that they traded pretty much every young guy that they could or draft picks that they could to get Anthony Davis and Paul George, so there's not a lot left there. But if the Clippers or Lakers had any assets, they would love to have a player like Tristan Thompson. And if they would love to have a player like Tristan Thompson, you can bet your bottom dollar that a lot of teams will. So Tristan Thompson has value. Brandon Knight had 13 points last night, basically coming off the scrap heap. And again, he may not have a ton of value like Tristan or Kevin Love, but what could be interesting is, does a team go, hey, Knight can help us a little bit, and maybe we have somebody on a 2-year contract that we don't love. So, hey, we'll throw in a 2 second round picks or this young guy that just is buried behind. Doubtful, obviously, for the first round pick, but can we dump a contract so we get one less year on that contract? We think Knight can help us a little bit, and we have to give up this young player, this these 2 second round picks, whatever it is. Knight could could, again, I'm not saying he will, but he could have value. John Henson has value. You watch the Cavaliers this year and you see what a real rim protector looks like, and it's weird, it's strange. You know, Henson's not 7'3" protecting the rim, but he is a real rim protector. He is someone that teams have to worry about, even as rail thin as he is. So I think John Henson is going to have some trade value. Now, if the Cavs trade Tristan Thompson, does Henson stay? If they trade Love, you know, all of this stuff plays together, but there's value there. Matthew Dellavedova, no, I'm just kidding. Matthew Dellavedova does not have trade value unless it is he's at the end of his contract and the Cavs are willing to swallow a 2 or 3 more year deal on someone who's not very good. Deli doesn't have value. Sorry about that. But then the other one is Dante Exum, who just got brought over. Obviously, he was sick last night, but 28 points the game before that, which was his career high. He's got 1.5 years left on his contract. He was the number 5 overall pick. He makes a little over $9 million. Cavs see a lot of value in that. Unlikely that they'll deal him, but if they're able to show his value this year, starting of next year, or this year going into the offseason, I think Dante Exum could bring back some value, right? He already brought with him a couple second-round picks. So I think there's a lot to be said about the vets on this team having trade value, both now and into the short future, that can help this team in the rebuild. While being on the team, I think, has been a great help. The long term is slowly but surely trading off some of these pieces to add other pieces, whether it's young guys, picks, or whatever, as well as opening up playing time like they did in the Jordan Clarkson deal. Listen, it's not easy being a Cavs fan. The same way at some level it's not easy being an Indians fan at times. There's no perfect way. There's no easy way. It just isn't. The Browns have made everything complicated. But I think we understand Kevin Love. It's not easy. Again, compared to quote-unquote real life, Kevin Love's life is easy. But for him, it's not easy. I think the rebuild is where it needs to be. And I think the Cavs have a lot of value with their vets. So while it's not always fun every night, Cavs fans, the Cavs are where they need to be. This is just how the NBA has it set up right now. We'll see if they can pull it off long-term. Can they find a 1A? Is Darius Garland that? I think we know Colin Sexton isn't. Is Kevin Porter Jr. that? I don't know. In the NBA, you need that. But maybe the Cavs go counterculture. Maybe they go to an Atlanta Hawks, Detroit Pistons thing where there's just a bunch of good players that know what they're doing and are good at what they do. We'll see if it all works out. But I think John Beilein is the right coach. Or a good coach. I don't know if right means there's only one right one. He's a good coach. His system and his culture, I think, are coming together. So, Cavs fans, we are where we need to be. We're not where we want to be. But I think they'll get there. Thank you for stopping by the Mueller Sports Report today, January 8th, Wednesday morning, talking all about your Cleveland Cavaliers. Again, I am your host, Jared Mueller. And get me hold of me on Twitter at Jared K. Mueller. That's at JaredKMuellER. And again, thank you for stopping by the Mueller Sports Report. Have a great day. Be healthy. Do good things for other people. And go Cavs.